The afternoon session is by Dr. Nagasuma Chandra from the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. She'll give a lecture and one more.
Thanks very much, Vijay. It's a great pleasure to be here at a very impressive campus. It's my first visit to the campus, but it's really nice. So this is mainly aimed as a primer for people with some background in biology, but I'll try to make it as general as possible to cater to everybody. Primer into what sort of data is available today, what kind of analysis and modeling is possible. Please, the way I've planned it is we'll give an introduction for this first slot, 1.5 hours or so. And then my graduate student Satya will actually give a demo so that it will be more useful to the participants, you know, so that you can go and she will also show you the open access tools that are available and how to do the demo. Feel free to interrupt me at any time and then we'll make it interactive. Okay, so coming to the data, I think most of you may be familiar. The data of all types of data and different levels of biological hierarchy that are available today. I think the resolution for some reason is not very good, but if you can read this, these are at the molecular level, you know, where genomic data is actually available in terms of genome sequences. We have the DNA sequence and the translated proteome sequence available for many, many organisms today, and also for different disease kind of situations. For a person with cancer, you know, the entire exome is sequenced today. Exome, again, for those of you who are not familiar with the jargon, is the complete complement or the complete composition of all the exons, genes, the coding regions of the exons which translate to proteins. So exome, in other words, is what actually is a counterpart of the proteome. And the word ome here, I mean the term ome here, just stands for the comprehensive coverage of the entire thing that is there in a cell. Genome refers to all the genes that are there in a cell. Proteome refers to all the proteins that are there in the cell and so on. And when we say all the genes that are there, it is what are theoretically there. So out of them, some may be present in a given situation, some may not be present, but a large number of them have been validated and people do not really worry about whether, you know, the translation is of high confidence or whether we need to worry about how to do a gene to protein translation and so on. Using the standard genetic code, we can actually convert the genome to a proteome. Expression values is the next level of data. So that's what I mean here by sequences. And sequences are now strings. Right, if I can use the board. So we will write A, G, C, T in different combination. This will be our DNA sequence. Convert that into an mRNA. You know, we have DNA to RNA to protein, the standard the dogma of molecular biology. We have sequences of all of them. The alphabet here is not different, only 4 letters at a time. Whereas for proteins, we have 20 amino acids. And the protein sequences are, again, we can go on like this. K for lysine, each one stands for one amino acid, a single letter code. You can go on writing the amino acids and different protein sequences. So the data we have is at the level of sequences, which means it is like it's like a sentence of some kind without gaps or anything of that kind. But in reality, they do not actually exist as strings of this kind, right? It's not the string theory strings, but these are just ordinary strings, if you can call it, just text. Letters, strings of letters. There are pattern matching algorithms that are available, which people have used quite successfully to analyze these sequences. I'm not going to emphasize on that today at all, just to give you a background that I'm speaking about this. So we can refer to this as a primary structure. In reality, these are three-dimensional objects, right? Each protein molecule has a three-dimensional structure, and you should be looking at it at the level of three-dimensional information that is available out there. And why is that so? Because it is the three-dimensional structure that is what gives rise to function. Okay? It is a little bit of a chicken and an egg problem. Has the structure evolved to suit a particular function, or has the function come as a consequence of the structure? Anyway, that's not the debate that we are looking at today. What we can very confidently take home from this is structure and function are correlated very, very well. Okay, so that's the thing. There is a primary, and we call this as a tertiary structure, which is why I wrote it like this. There's something in between called a secondary structure, which is something like a local structure. Most of you would have heard of the term helices and beta sheets and so on. So this is what is referred to as a secondary structure. Again, I'm not getting into all of those things. Tertiary structure refers to the three-dimensional structure of a single subunit of a protein molecule, right? And sometimes we also have a higher order structure, which we call as a quaternary structure. Typically in a molecule like hemoglobin, we have two alpha subunits, two beta subunits coming together to become a functional molecule. And that is a quaternary structure. Some do not require this, some proteins require this. So this is the hierarchy in the structure. And again, the term function means different things to different people, right? Function can mean that it is important for cell division, or this protein is essential for the growth of a bacteria, perhaps, you know. Function can be described at many levels. But for us, when we go from this level upwards, function will mean molecular recognition. Is it capable of recognizing another protein molecule? Or is it capable of recognizing another small molecule? You know, take, for example, the process of digestion. Take hexokinase, which is the first enzyme in a pathway called glycolysis pathway. Again, those who have read biochemistry, this may be in one of the early classes of biochemistry. What does hexokinase do? Of course, you can call its function as something important for digestion, something important for energy generation, and so on and so forth. But at the molecular level, the function is to recognize glucose. The glucose that is degraded from the food is bound to this protein in a non-covalent manner. These are non-covalent interactions stabilizing the binding of glucose to hexokinase. It also binds another substrate, which is its cofactor, ATP, and phosphorylates. Glucose becomes glucose 6-phosphate, and reactions go on from there. So in order to do any further function, it must necessarily recognize this small molecule, ligand, like a key getting into the lock, into the keyhole, and so on. So at that level, we kind of abstract function, which is useful to build up higher level things that I'm going to talk about today. So what we have here at the molecular components is sequences and structures. We can look at it like that. And then comes the metabolic pathways. So we do have data all through here. We also have different methods to model here, which I think it is difficult for you to read, but I will talk about it. So for some reason, the slide has gone bad today. Never mind. So we have molecular components, sequences, and structures. So we have the components, DNA, RNA, protein. Sometimes they're not always translated into protein. You also have RNA, which just exists as RNA. We also have small molecules, which are called as metabolites. And when these are covered comprehensively, it becomes the genome, the transcriptome for RNA, because it's the transcript is what we call it as, the transcriptome, the proteome, and the metabolome. Okay, there are other things such as people use lipidome and things like that, which, as you can guess very well, it is the total component or of the lipid content of the cell. So that's the lipidome. In fact, if those of you are interested, there is a website just for fun called Omics Mania, which gives you a list of different omics that you can think of. Okay, it's not so much for the jargon, but it's to think of what sort of data that is available. I think it's a good thing to go and visit that site. Omicsmania.com or something. If you Google for Omics Mania, I think you'll get it. In how many different ways can you generate data, at least, you know, that information will get out of that. That will all come here. Methylome will be in the DNA. So whether it is in methylated or not methylated. And that is related to how much of it is translated or not. Anything that is methylated is suppressed. It's not expressed. So you will get methylome, epigenome, whatever you want to call. There are lots of variations of this kind. Okay. So we have information on that. If you have the DNA sequence and you know which one is methylated, when, where. So that is the next order of level of information. Okay. So the next level comes here. Okay. So at this level, we have the models that we can, you know, either mentally think of or do mathematically and computationally will be sequence to function models or structure to function models. You know, sequence is like what are the components that make up a protein? Like I told you, KATA, whatever. Each one is for different. Each one is different for a different protein and so on. This folds up into a complex three-dimensional object. I don't have any pictures here, but most of you may have seen some pictures of protein structures somewhere, which is dependent on the sequence. So sequence dictates structure and structure dictates function. So if you have the structural information, it's like looking at the lock. You know, a lock is available to you. Can you guess what the function of this lock is by figuring out what sort of a key will fit into the keyhole? So that is the structure to function model. Okay, because if you know what binds to it, then you have a clue of what sort of function it may have and so on. So we have here sequence to function models. And this area is primarily in the realm of bioinformatics. Okay. Then we have structure to function models, same logic, but we have much better information and a much more challenging task of analysis, because analyzing structures is not as analyzing sequences themselves is not trivial, is not a joke, but analyzing structures becomes much, much more complex, because for every residue you have, for each atom you have XYZ coordinates. And you must connect them. There's a problem of topology, the problem of connection. Pulling out the information from that has many challenges. There are a lot of advances. Many methods are also available for that. So structure to function models are available. And within this, you have areas like substructure to function models. This, for example, now to give an analogy of the lock again, is just to look at the keyhole. So we have the keyhole, which is a substructure, and we have the substructure to function models, rather than, you know, it doesn't really matter what sort of a shape a lock has, but what really matters for its function is what shape the keyhole has. So it's just sufficient to look at the keyhole, for example. So those are the models, substructure to function models. In fact, we've had some work in this area, and there's a suite of algorithms developed by my previous student. I think you can go to pocket depth, pocket match, and a whole lot of things, pocket align, pocket annotate, and so on. These are all accessible to everybody, you know, web service which are accessible to everybody. So you can go and use it if you like. You know, there are a whole range of tools that are available out there. So those are substructure to function models. So let's say we can annotate the genome, show you a couple of examples. The next level of information is in terms of biochemical reactions, signaling reactions, regulatory reactions, and so on. An example again is a transcription factor. A transcription factor is somewhat like a controller, right? If a transcription factor binds to its target, it can either trigger its expression, or it's like a switch in some words. If you put on the switch, some lights can be off and some lights can be on. But we also have a control of how much and each bulb can glow. So we have a way of controlling the intensity of this glow, basically. So that's nothing but the expression levels, going back to the genes. And so how much of the transcript is present, and how many copies of protein can be made from this? You know, that's the kind of information we have. So that is experimentally measured through proteome measurements, typically mass spectrometry kind of measurements, or also 2D gels that people have used in the past, you know, electrophoresis kind of systems. So we have the proteome kind of measurements. So once you have this, they're doing something. There's a sequence of logical steps sometimes which give rise to cascade of events. So it can be like transcription factor to target expression, okay? And it could be TF to TF to TF, there are multiple transcription factors. Everything is governed by molecular recognition events. A transcription factor either goes and binds another protein, another TF, or it binds to the, you know, the nucleic acid of the, which is its target, and therefore either enables or suppresses the expression of those things. Anyway, once sufficient number of them are made, a typical example now to give you will be a set of enzymes which will lead to a metabolic pathway. That's the easiest to understand. And I already talked about hexokinase. Hexokinase is one such enzyme. Hexokinase now binds glucose and converts it into glucose 6-phosphate. So what happens to the glucose 6-phosphate next? It's converted into fructose 6-phosphate, fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. A series of steps that happen, and ultimately we get pyruvate. Okay, there are about 10 steps here. Each one, 10 different enzymes are present, some cofactors are present. In the process, it generates ATP. But this logical sequence of steps is called as a pathway, a biochemical pathway. Somewhat like if you set a ball free on a sloping hill, it has to stop only where it is, it will meet its logical end. So all of these are necessarily driven by the thermodynamic slope that we have. So the delta G values that are out there, so on. So this is a pathway. And like this, there are at least some 150, 200 different pathways that are well characterized. These are all for metabolism. We call them as metabolism when energy is, when the nutrients are degraded, there's catabolism, and therefore energy is generated, or also for anabolic pathways, which are building up of, proteins, the cell walls, the membranes, the various organelles that are there, so on and so forth. So there's catabolism from the food, there's energy production, and there is utilization also for anabolism. So these are the metabolic pathways. There are signaling pathways, other than these pathways, there are signaling pathways. Like, for example, a hormone, an insulin, when food is, when the glucose levels are, either up or down, a lot of metabolic changes have to happen. And these cannot happen unless something is controlling it. And this control comes from the signaling pathways, typically. Right? The insulin is a hormone which is sensed by its receptors. Again, a lot of protein-protein interactions, phosphorylation, dephosphorylation kind of events, which will finally lead to a control or homeostasis that we see and so on. So there are signaling pathways in the cell. There are also regulatory pathways, like I told you, for transcription factor and so on, and various types of regulation in the cell. Many are interlinked. They're highly interlinked with each other, very well orchestrated, which is what makes life, so very, I won't call life as predictable, but all reactions in a cell, each minute when it is happening, it is pretty predictable, because we understand what is the capability or capacity of each one is understood very easily when you go down to that level. So that's the next level of data here. So a large number of modeling strategies are available for this, which, again, to give you an example, take a biochemical reaction or a signaling pathway. It can be modeled in terms of ordinary differential equations, rate equations, basically. So you know the concentration of the starting point, the velocity of that reaction, you know the abundance of the particular protein that is catalyzing that reaction. You can calculate all the intermediates at various points in time. Yes, please. So these are available through experimental measurements. For biochemical things, it is available. And if you know a reasonable number of them, the others can be guessed. There are parameter estimation methods are quite standardized these days. Yeah.
So without, we have no practical experience.
Okay.
We are not biologists, so laboratory and do it. So
okay.
With non-theoretical process, we find few metabolites is available. This one is experimental, but few not available. So how we?
If you know the velocity of the reaction, right? The V max values, what we call them as. And if you also know the Km value, that is the affinity of this protein, of the substrate to the protein, and protein for the substrate and so on, then you can calculate how tightly it binds. And you have an initial population of molecules of your substrate, and you can calculate how much of it will be recognized by this protein and how fast it will be turned over. So the next product, for example, the glucose 6-phosphate to whatever, here to 2 and 2 to 3 and so on, we can calculate how much of 2 is there, how much of 3 is there, how much of 4 is there and so on. This is what ODEs do. And they're coupled. They're all coupled ODEs, and there are solvers which will do it quite easily for you for a single pathway at a time. A limitation of that is you can't expand it to larger systems because of the nature of the thing, and also limitation of the availability of data. So there are other methods. One example is what's called as a flux balance analysis method, which has come from chemical engineering kind of disciplines. Elementary flux analysis, flux balance analysis, constraint-based analysis of various kinds. Again, I'm not touching upon those things because that was not the focus today. Okay. So very recently at IMSC, in fact, I spoke about it. That may be online, I'm not sure. There may be a recorded lecture available. It was only last week I was talking about it. Okay, so that is at this level, metabolic pathways and biochemical pathways. And you will notice this is the bottom-up approach. Whereas if you go from the top-down approach, this is typically it's the realm of theoretical biology, which some of you may have been familiar with. I'll come to that in a minute. So the next level here is network models. So you don't have information of, let us say, rates or concentrations or anything of the kind, but you know who is connected to who. It's somewhat like having a telephone directory. That is the genome sequence here. You have a list of people with their some identity, some number and so on. But to know what sort of a function that can come out of that, you need to know who is talking to whom. So if you have that information, we can project them as graphs or networks. So in a city, you have information of which number is calling whom, for how long and how frequently and so on and so forth. That you can project it as a graph. And that's very similar to which protein is interacting with which other protein or metabolite or RNA or DNA or whatever that may be. Again, it's a graph. In this graph now, I will talk about it in more detail later on. You have nodes and edges, right? Using graph theory methods, which have a very strong mathematical foundation, right? Nodes can be individual molecules, and the edges are when they talk to each other, you draw an edge. So there's the interactions between the nodes. So that's when you get networks. And a large number of methods that are available using networks to do that. Some of them we'll see later on, we go along. And we have, sometimes this kind of information is also not available, but we simply know part information here, part information there, and so on, which is actually a very common scenario. So many times it has been modeled as logical models or Boolean models. A and B gives rise to C, A and B plus D gives rise to E, you know, something of the kind, depending on those things. So Boolean rules have been used, and people have, again, used that. So many of these are used also in high data intensive areas such as astronomy. So you will find a lot of parallels between in the approaches between these areas. And then you can, if you take cell as a starting point, because cell I think is reasonably justified to take cell as a starting point because it is a self-contained unit which has a complete genome, complete proteome, because there are variations from cell to cell, but it is reasonably decent to take that. And if you look at organisms like bacteria, you know, a cell is an organism, so there is no problem at all. So that's the starting point. From then, you go on to higher level things such as multi-scale responses. An example is how a cancer forms or how a cancer migrates from one area to another area. There's lots of tissue-tissue interaction, cell-cell interaction that has to take place. So there are models for that. Again, networks can be used throughout here. Networks, in fact, can be used at the level of protein structure also, or even for sequence assembly, people have used networks. So it depends on how you formulate the problem. You can actually use it anyway. So multi-scale responses, cellular automata, game theory, all these kind of things have been used. A type of multi-scale response is a host-pathogen interaction. Now, let's say there is a flu virus around, right? Influenza virus. Influenza virus, now one has to, an individual host has to get exposed to this virus, and then there needs to be interaction of a specific kind where the virus or any bacterium that causes the infection is not killed by the host responses, but it is allowed to grow. It somehow escapes the immune response and then it becomes a full-blown infection. So there are a large number of very complex set of interactions that are going on, which is shown in this layer called host-pathogen interactions, really. And one can take it all the way up to something like disease epidemiology. Can you actually find out, will a large number of people in a given geographical location get flu at a given time or not? And those kind of questions can be answered. This has come from a top-down approach traditionally, but today I think it is possible to, you know, bridge from one end to the other, whichever way you start. Okay, so this is now population dynamics, again ODE type of models. A very well-known type of modeling strategy is called SIR models. S standing for susceptible, I for infected, and R for recovered individual. So population dynamics kind of a strategy is utilized at this level. Each one can be a separate lecture of its own for an hour or so, but that's not the focus again. So let's move on to other areas. Okay, a quick example of the sequence to structure levels. So this is an example of a bacterial genome, Mycobacterium tuberculosis, and as the name suggests, causes TB. The genome here is shown here, about it codes for about, this is the number of base pairs that you will see, 4 million, 4 point something million. It codes for about 4,000 different proteins, right? And out of these 4,000 proteins, about 3,500 or so are expressed at any given point in time. Expressed, when I say expressed, it is switched on basically. Some are switched on more, some are switched on less. But today we have the data that is available to us to experimentally determine which is expressed when and by how much. At one shot, we can get the entire transcriptome That's what I will talk about later on. So we do have the transcriptome data for that. But from the genome, what information do we have? I mean, it is impossible for anybody to work on every single protein in every single organism. So we can't say we will only do experimental work and then learn from it. We must learn from the knowledge that we have from related organisms, related proteins, and so on, which is why bioinformatics as a discipline becomes inevitable. It is an integral part now of any biological analysis, especially when it involves a high throughput or a large scale study of any kind, becomes important. Again, I really apologize. All slides look fine on my laptop, but they're very, very fudged here. I don't understand what happened. The TB genome is circular. Yeah, yeah. Is there something we can do to change the resolution? Or we will connect the machine? Yeah. Okay. Sorry about this, because I think you can't read anything then. It doesn't matter. I think we'll just go on. No problem. Okay. So what I was telling you here is for each protein, we have information about what sort of proteins are now organized into families. So which family it belongs to, what sort of a function it has, is it an enzyme or is it a transcription factor, is it a membrane, kind of a membrane bound or in, you know, a transmembrane kind of protein, those kind of information is available. And which are all the related proteins that is there. Somewhere here that information is there. So what's called as a BLAST search. BLAST is an acronym for sequence alignment. You know, you search across sequence databases and then identify all those similar to it. So you get something like that. So it will tell you whether this protein is conserved in bacteria, if it is a bacterial protein. Is it also present in the host? Is it also present in other kind of clades of the life tree, such as plants or, you know, whatever. That kind of information is available, you know, very immediately for almost all proteins. It will also tell you something about the domain architecture. You know, protein can be 2,000 amino acids long, but then it is split into some domain, self-contained units. So that is the picture that you see here. And each domain now has a better link with a function than the whole protein, because you can't. A domain could be a kinase domain, a domain can be an ATP binding domain, or a domain can be some other kind of function, such as it has this catalytic triad or whatever that may be. So these domains now become much more amenable for analysis and association with a function. So that information is available out there. It is like a module, basically. So for 4,000 proteins, for something like 3,000 proteins today, we have reasonable amount of functional information, much of it obtained from sequence, some more that is either obtained or verified, or higher level of insight obtained from structures, three-dimensional structures. In fact, we have modeled for about 3,000 different proteins from tuberculosis, and you get some structural information from that. Okay, so this is available. So this is like, you know, having a telephone directory with name and address and everything of that particular city. So what is the next step, basically? In fact, the methods to do that. Sorry, I've lost. So the methods to do that are sequence alignments. Again, these are very well standardized today and used quite widely. So this is an example of multiple sequence alignments. It uses some variation at some point, at least. There are heuristics that are utilized here. But to get a good alignment, Smith and Waterman and Needleman-Munch kind of algorithms are utilized to get a very good. These are dynamic programming kind of methods. Again, we're not getting into that area right now. Okay, so we will move on to the next level. That's a transcript. So we have some understanding of the sequence of the protein, the structure of the protein, and what it does. Next, we must go on to the transcripts, because that's what we are going to focus on, transcriptome, and the network analysis is what I will touch upon. So I told you that we have information today in the last 10 plus years that the technology has emerged such that we can capture the entire transcriptome at a given time point. What is actually in a transcriptome? In fact, there's a very nice review article by Madan Babu from Cambridge, which I can pass on if you like, which gives you a very good introduction to microarrays. There are many advances today, but this should give you a good starting point at least. So each spot, you know, it's divided into spots. If you look at Mycobacterium tuberculosis, we have a chip which is printed with this kind of DNA as the probe. So each little dot here is a spot. It contains many copies of the same DNA sequence that uniquely represents a gene from an organism. Okay, again, many variants of that. For RNA you can do, for DNA you can do, and so on. So you have some material that is already available here, that is your starting chip. And from your sample, if the complementary thing is available, it will hybridize, and it will tell us when it is hybridized and by how much. So that's the whole logic out here. So these spots are arranged in an orderly fashion. So you can either have it like this, or you can have multiple conditions in the same array. That is the typically, that is how it is today. So for MTB kind of chip, I'll have 1 to 4,000 rows. And I'll have columns, and I think in a chip you get 8 or 12 or something like that. So the first 2 or 3 can be controls, means in a wild type situation when there's no perturbation and so on. And the next ones can be, let's say, control. It's not really a control. Either you can have control plus different media, or you can have a mutant, for example. Mutant again, 1, 2, 3, and so on and so forth. And then you can compare them all together. So that's how it generally works. So you can compare the same thing in two direction, in two conditions. Okay. So what you get here is a schematic of the experimental protocol to study differential expression of genes. So the organism is typically grown in two conditions, a reference condition and a test condition. A condition could be, like I said, a mutation that you have engineered into the genome. Some particular protein you have knocked off, some gene you have knocked off, or you have made a point mutation. In the protein, you have made a single point mutation to abolish its function, or for gain of function, whatever that may be. So two different conditions. It can also be different nutrients. So instead of glucose as the carbon source, you have put in, say, glycerol as the carbon source. So what happens to the bacteria? Okay, it can also be in the presence of drugs. If you put in a drug at a suboptimal concentration, what actually happens to that, and so on. So condition A and condition B, then RNA is extracted from the two cells, is labeled with different dyes. So each RNA that's extracted, in condition 1, it's labeled with one dye, which may be red in color. Condition 2, it is labeled with another dye, which can be green in color. So to make that, the cDNA is synthesized by reverse transcriptase. So once you get these two dyes and you allow it to hybridize, you can find out how much of the green color is coming and how much of the red color is coming in each little well that you see. So in each position here, you see how much of what is coming, which is green, which is red, and so on. And the ratio of this green to red or red to green or whatever will tell you which is predominant. Since if both are equal, you'll get a ratio of 1. If red is 4 times more than green, you'll get a ratio of 4, and vice versa. That kind of a thing is what you will actually get. Yeah, it's working now. Thank you. Okay. So the microarray slide is then excited with the laser at suitable wavelengths to detect the red and the green dyes. The final image is stored as a file for further analysis. And because it's a high throughput thing and things could go wrong, everything depends on image analysis, as you will see. Usually the two types of controls that are done. One is called a technical replicate. Exactly the same condition, same thing, you repeat it twice, thrice. So you'll have, either triplicate or replicates. You'll have A, B, C, which is necessarily the same thing. You're doing it thrice, basically. That's called a technical replicate. And you look for some sort of agreement between them and take either a median value or so on and so forth. Another kind of thing that we do quite often is to take a biological replicate. Technical replicate should be necessarily closer to each other. Biological replicate is you do the experiment again, take a fresh sample of bacteria, similar conditions, everything is the same, but this captures the heterogeneity that is naturally there in biological samples. So you get a biological replicate. Again, depending on the resources available, people do 3 or 4 or whatever. The minimum should be 2, as you can guess very well. And you take, sometimes people do take an average, which is not a very good idea, but you can take a median value if there is enough statistics to go by. Okay, so that is what you do. A variation to this is also not to combine both into the same well, but to do a single channel. You do one first, and in the parallel one, you do another, and so on. So you don't have to measure ratios like this, but you can measure how much of red is there in one well, how much of green is in another well, and then compare them so that they don't mask each other. So that is the measurement that is made. much of this individually you will not require to actually worry about, but it is important to know because there is equipment and technology that is standardized, and most often this is not done in each lab, but it will either be a central facility or a facility provider, which could even be a commercial company and so on. That's where you get this from. And how do you actually analyze this? So the spot area and the background area are depicted here by a blue circle. Just an example spot is taken with a box. A pixel in the spot is also shown. So this is a pixel which is blown up. Now, any pixel within the circle will be treated as a signal from the spot. You're basically measuring signal intensity, how much of the signal is there and so on. And in order to get an intensity that is indicative of your biological sample and not of the background, several steps must be carried out. The first one will be background correction. So there is some amount of background. Okay, so there are again very good methods to do that. So background is corrected in the sense you compensate for the background that will be there everywhere, and taking a large number of spots and taking a median and looking at distributions of intensities and so on. So these images are not perfect, as is often the case, which leads to many problems with spurious signals. Could be dust, could be scratches, could be bright arrays, anything for that matter. This is all from this particular paper that you can see. So the next thing is to see if you want to compare two kinds of samples, you want to see if they are in a comparable range in the first place. So are their mean values the same or are their median values the same? That's the kind of question that people ask. You can either plot them like this. So you do some sort of rescaling such that you do not change the intensity values of gene 1 with respect to gene 2 in a relative sense within an array, but you rescale the whole thing. 1, 2, 3, 4 in column 1 can be rescaled to see that 1, 2, 3, 4 in the column 2 is matched. For example, if you have a set of marks of two individuals of 100 to 0 in one and minus 5 to 20 in another one, they're not comparable really. So you need to normalize them, you need to scale them so that they're comparable. That's the kind of exercise you do here. And there are typically box plots which will show you the median value of each one and the range to show you that the ranges are in a comparable manner and so on. So this particular method that is used here is called mean centering. So before and after, there are minor changes that happen to the average values out here, but that is sufficient for us to get the signal correctly from the noise that will be out there. So this kind of methods are usually shown. And this is an example of a normalization kind of a thing. So again, normalization is a scaling procedure. When you're looking at two, and there are people do it either hierarchically or different filters are used in place. It could also be something like a quantile normalization. I think most of you will be familiar with the percentile kind of a thing. For comparing marks, you have a percentile kind of a thing. So that is what is taken. The highest one will get the highest 100th percentile, and then it goes low as the marks go down. So, and usually what is taken is called a 75th quantile normalization. So everything over the 75th percentile only is considered and the rest are not considered because that's of high confidence. So something may have gone wrong, for example, in measurements and so on and so forth. Therefore, you ignore all those things and take only the high confidence kind of a thing. Yet another kind of filter that's put in place is the p-value. The usual p-value that you will see, it should be less than 0.05 kind of a thing. So this just tells you what is the statistical significance between multiple columns of the same kind of sample and so on. So that's the measurement that is done. And you can have before and after normalization these kind of images. So you can also selectively show only those that matter, like a 75th quantile thing. Do not look at changes that may be there, but not really clear to us. So you take only those that are clear changes and so on. Then different ways of representing this gene expression data, for example. One is an absolute measurement, intensity, with some numbers, whatever you are measuring, basically, can be like this. But that's rarely useful. So, and also, it can be skewed, especially when you're taking ratios. So, plus, if you're looking at ratios of, say, C1 to C4, if it is 25 in one and 100 in the other one, it is a fourfold change. But when you look at 100 to 25, you'll make it as 0.25. That's not very useful to look at the down-regulated ones. So we call these as up-regulated and down-regulated, typically. And these are usually referred to as DEGs or differentially expressed genes. When you're comparing condition 2 to condition 1, in condition to if a given gene is much more abundant, then it is called as an upregulated gene. Again, to give you an example, can be a healthy individual and could be somebody with a disease like cancer. It's the same tissue, same thing. And the same gene will have some intensity here, but a higher intensity out there. Something is expressed in higher quantities. The fold change of this to that will be about 4 or 3 or whatever that may be. So these are called differentially expressed genes. You can also have it the other way around. What is high here can be low there. Something has been suppressed. An example could be immune genes in an infection situation. It is down-regulated. So you have this. P-value is to see whether to consider that gene or not further for analysis. That will only tell you is there consensus or not. That's a separate thing. Fold change is the actual data that you are getting out of the variations that occur in a biological condition. Okay, p-value is just a filter. Do you have consensus among replicates or not is what it will tell you. Okay. So this is, so what is typically done is a log fold change is taken because the data is transformed into a log value, so a log to base 2. So it becomes easier and it is also continuous and symmetric about the mean. So that is why people take this. So log to base 2 and relative measurements. And sometimes you can also take it as yes or no kind of a thing. If it is upregulated, you take it as 1. Otherwise, you take it as 0. If it is downregulated, you take it as minus 1. So because these are all threshold dependent, when I'm looking at the value here to the value there, so when do you call it as upregulated is a question. If it is over, now let us say if it is greater than a value of 2, then you can say it is upregulated twofold and therefore consider it. That depends on your thresholds. Quite often 2 is the default. Sometimes you want to take it as 3. If it is upregulated more than 3 times, threefold basically, then I will want to consider it or I will not want to consider it as a differentially expressed gene. These are the kind of decisions one makes. And then you simply say 0 or 1 based on your cutoff that you give. And this helps in many other situations, you know, to either identify this and design some experiments based on that and so on and so forth. You may not need a quantitative value in some situations, just a qualitative. From quantitative, you've converted back into a qualitative decision and that may be sufficient as well. So those are these kind of values that you see here. Gene A, and see in different conditions what is actually happening is what you are looking at. Okay. Okay, so once you get data like this, you may want to now ask two questions. One is, let us say I have in the same condition, like say tuberculosis infected people, right? I have samples from 1,000 individuals here. So are they all similar or are they all different? So at the patient level, I might want to do a clustering exercise. I may have people from, say, you know, one city, another city, one country, another country, one race, whatever that may be, different types of data that I have. So I want to look for commonalities in them. Then I might want to see which one is similar to which other one. Are there similarities at all? You know, that's one question.
I have a question. You talked about microRNA.
Yeah.
So RNA sequencing is fastly becoming popular.
Then. Yeah, yeah. So, I'll come to that, yes.
How long will it take to get, how long the microRNA will take to become obsolete?
Like. Okay, I don't think it should become obsolete personally. RNA-seq is superior in many ways, but it doesn't necessarily replace microarray because the technology is different. There are some things that you will miss in RNA-seq as compared to microarray. I do have a comparison I will show you in a minute. Yeah. Okay. Okay, so the second type of question is to find out which genes are behaving similarly within this array. Like the human genome, you have 20,000 different genes, even if you take just the coding ones, right? So among these 20,000, which ones are behaving similarly and which ones are different? That's the kind of question you can ask. And you make blocks. And these blocks are nothing but clusters. So you need to do some sort of a clustering exercise to do that. And two common ways that you will use in any kind of a situation is hierarchical, non-hierarchical. And within this, is it agglomerative or divisive kind of clustering? I'll just show you some examples of both. Okay, so this is a picture that is showing you agglomerative and divisive clustering. Agglomerative here, that is you either increase it, you start from 1 or 2 and start growing it incrementally and then make clusters of this kind. or the divisive is the inverse approach. You start with everything as a single cluster and remove what is not similar to that. So basically here, you take two genes, the profile of two genes in different conditions. If they're very similar to each other, you group them into one group or one block. And so to do that, you must compute a distance between these two gene profiles. So that is very similar now to a barcode, right? You're all familiar with barcodes. Now you want to compare two barcodes and see whether they're similar or not. If they're very similar to each other, some distance of Pearson's correlations, Spearman distance, these are the standard things that people use. You take some sort of a distance, ranked correlation or whatever, and if the distance is less than a threshold T, then you group them together. And the distance will be very stringent to start with, like in a scale of 0 to 1, the distance may be 0.1, for example. But in the next level, you relax the distance threshold a little bit and then go on adding the next one and the next one until you get a good enough sized group. So that is a clustering exercise that you see here, right? So if you're looking at two genes, this step one and step two here, these two genes are very similar to each other, therefore they are grouped. And then you add the next one, next level of similarity, that may be a different set of genes here. So you get one more cluster and start linking them up until finally you get this pattern. But a divisive clustering is the inverse. You start with a single thing and anything that is slightly different from it, you remove it from that and you go on removing or finding clusters like that until you get back the same pattern from this. But because this is a small example here, you do get the similar patterns. But if you do it for a large real data set, there will be differences between a clustering that you get here and there, but overall the information may be similar. So the approach of course matters, but it won't matter to such an extent that your results are 100% different. You know what I mean? So there are some sensitivities and things like that which will obviously be different, and therefore the choice is important. But the nature of the results that you get should be similar to each other at least. And how do you actually find the distance between two clusters? The clustering exercise itself does this iteratively. There are different methods, again, single linkage clustering. You take the shortest distance between group A and group B in this one, cluster 1 and cluster 2. The minimal distance that is out there, or it could be the maximal distance. On the other hand, you can look at complete linkage clustering. This must all be within, you know, you get a higher threshold there, and then this must be completely linked. Or you look at average linking thing, each one to each one, what is the distance, and get an average between them. Or could be just the centroid of this and the centroid of that. It's of different ways, but implementation varies, and therefore the results will vary depending on how exactly you do the thing. But they will vary in a finer grid, but overall they should be similar. So this is an example of hierarchical clustering using single linkage algorithm. Now ABCD could be 5 genes here. Genes, and there you have now a vector of their expression values in different conditions. So you compare them, and here A and B are very similar to each other, though the distance is only 1, as compared to A to C, which is 2, and so on. So AB comes into one group, DE comes into another group, C is closer to A and B, which is what you see in the dendrogram out here, whereas D and E form a separate cluster. So this is the logic that is followed. And like I said, for the human genome, you have 20,000 once, and even if at a time 15,000 or some number like that are expressed, you will have a large clustering exercise on your hand to do. Okay. A common method involving non-hierarchical methods is called k-means clustering. Again, these are used not just in biology, but many, many disciplines basically. So here you basically divide objects or group into a predefined number of clusters. You can say I want 10 baskets for all my genes that are there. And that's the initialization step. Centroid for each cluster is calculated, and objects are regrouped depending on how close they are to available centroid. So take all the genes, group them into say 10 baskets or you know something like that. Take the based on their closest distance, and take the centroid of each one and see how far away is it, and you know then so on, and start refining this basically. It's performed iteratively until convergence. So that's a k-means type of clustering. Have a question? There are variants to this, obviously. So the standard way of doing it is you need some number of things. Sometimes people do it iteratively and decide the number of clusters also. So there are, again, many advances that are happening, obviously, in all of these fronts. You can have many, many different things associated with it, yeah. It's just to show you that what sort of analysis can be done. So some standard ones is what I have included here. There's also something called self-organizing maps. Again, a grid of nodes is projected onto the expression space, and each gene is assigned its closest node, basically. So following this step, one gene is chosen at random, and the assigned node is moved towards it. So the other nodes are moved towards this gene, depending on how close they are to the selected gene. Basically, again, all pairs of distances, and then assigning either a node here or a cluster or whatever that may be. You do it until iteratively until convergence, or perform for a fixed number of iteration to get a final map of nodes. No, no nodes will be a cluster in this particular case. There are different methods to do that, you know, basically. This is a list of tools that are available. Some are obsolete, but some are, and there are newer ones. Satya should will show you a demo of one of them at least today, later on. Okay, this is a question somebody was asking. RNA-seq and microarray. RNA-seq is the next generation sequencing kind of method, NGS method. So you can do two things with that. One is to actually read out the exome sequence. Basically, you know, exome or the whole genome sequence, you can read out because you are actually determining the sequence. And the second is to measure the abundance of a particular RNA that you are looking at, of all the RNA, entire transcripts. So there's slight differences in how they're implemented. So they're not done simultaneously for both purposes, but the basic logic is the same. Final implementation is slightly different. But RNA-seq is necessarily a more superior method to microarrays. In microarrays, the chances of errors can be slightly higher as compared to RNA-seq. So there's very recently, in fact, a 2015 paper compares RNA-seq and microarray-based models for clinical endpoint prediction for a particular disease, which is neuroblastoma in this case. And they've taken about 500 different neuroblastomas to compare. Same samples, do a microarray and also a RNA-seq and then compare. So the analysis for this or the data gathering itself is a different thing altogether. So here percentage of reads mapped to distinct targets are shown. So each sometimes a target is not covered very well, or sometimes one is covered more and so on. The problems are different at the initial processing stages. So to show you here the number of genes that are covered, this includes both coding and non-coding. So it's quite high. Number of transcripts, sometimes you can have multiple transcripts per gene, and the number of junctions between them. So that's what is shown. The coverage can be very high in RNA-seq as compared to the microarray. And this picture should give you an idea. This is an overlap of differentially expressed genes identified by RNA-seq and microarrays for the same disease subgroups. So you identify something like 21,000 or so as differentially expressed here out of all those transcripts that I showed you, whereas 11,000 in the microarray. The common ones, the large number of them is still common, but you get some which are missed out. So if you can afford, you should do both or one. It doesn't really matter so much to get an idea, in the sense whether you take a microarray data or an RNA-seq data, the characteristics of that particular condition is there in any case. Our own personal experience, you take tuberculosis patient data. This is human blood pardon me. So if you take human blood transcriptome data of healthy individuals and TB infected individuals, you don't instruct a clustering method. Sorry about this. Yeah. You don't provide any instructions, but simply take the data and see what you can gain out of it. Very neatly, you get a cluster of healthy individuals and TB infected individuals. And in fact, if you look at data of TB infected individuals treated over different time points, 0 months, 2 months, 4 months, 12 months, and so on, you will see neat clusters. And at 12 months, the cluster is actually merging with the healthy individuals. So what this suggests is that the profile that you see here of different genes is characteristic of that condition. Whether you do this with microarray data or RNA-seq data, we get the similar type of clusters. So there are minor variations, no doubt. In fact, if you compare them just at the DEG level, you may get very little in common. This may be a good example. You may get much worse many times. But if you compare them in terms of the significance that they provide, in terms of the biological significance, they become much more comparable. Okay? One way of doing that, kind of understanding the significance, is One way of looking at the significance is by looking at the gene function through something called an enrichment analysis. Now, you have a cluster of differentially expressed genes. What are the functional categories that these set of genes belong to? Are they enzymes? And if so, which pathways and so on and so forth is what one can actually measure. So if you do the enriched modules, like you can find out modules, if you compare the modules, then it becomes clear that both of them give you similar kind of results. In fact, there's new research that's going on to find out what is the best method to compare these kind of things, which means how do you extract the signal that is out there, either in microarray data or RNA-seq data, and especially, you know, for a given sample, they must be comparable because they're measuring the same things, although they're measuring them through different technologies altogether. So there is a method of that kind also that's available. There are a large number of servers which will do gene enrichment analysis also. I think one of them is called, again, an acronym. It's called David, basically. There are many servers that are available out there. So the challenges here are RNA sequencing itself. How do you actually read out the sequence? You know, because you get segments and then you need to put them together, assemble them and so on. So there's methods available. Top hat is one of the widely used ones. Whereas in microarray, it also depends on what platform, you know, who is making the chip, how is the chip made, how is the chip designed, and so on. These are again important factors. So two arrays of different platforms or the same sample also require a lot of work for comparison. Okay, so that's what it is. I'll skip the next few slides and. Okay, we'll move on to networks. To make sense out of these transcriptomes or whatever, if you remember the hierarchy that I showed you, we have like a telephone directory again. Now we have a telephone directory with even more detail to that, but we're still a telephone directory. In the sense, we have genome annotation, we have structure, we know what the person looks like, we know their other parameters or whatever that may be, but we also need to understand who talks to whom. That is the interaction that is absolutely important, which is still missing. In a transcriptome, we can't really get that information. We only know how many copies of each, if you like, you know, how many people are there in a house with one telephone number. That kind of detail is what we get from a transcriptome. But we need to know what is the purpose of that, what can they achieve, and who interacts with who, and so on. And that necessarily requires networks. Now, networks are of two types. One is from the transcriptome itself, people make what is called as correlation networks, gene expression correlation networks. So remember, I showed you the clustering pattern. If two genes are showing similar clustering, similar expression behavior, then you can draw an edge between them. You know, everything in a cluster will also have a densely connected kind of thing here. Each one being a gene here, each node being a gene, an edge being the level of correlation that exists between these kind of a thing. This is a common way of doing networks. And this itself will tell you which genes are clustered closely together and what is the enrichment in terms of function of these genes, basically. So you get an idea about whether these are all signaling proteins or whether these are all important for cell division or apoptosis or whatever.
Gene clustering is like, they are like, topologically clustered or they correspond to the same pathway?
No, nothing of the kind. See, what I showed you was, you remember the clustering thing, that this gene is showing similar expression behavior in multiple conditions or in two conditions. That's all it's showing. So it is all, they're equally switched on or equally switched off. And that's a correlation between them. And that correlation can be used to derive a network. Okay, so that's one type of a network. And this edge does not have a physical meaning. It only has a correlation here. These two are both present at the same time. That is the information you can get here. But that's one type of network. I'm going to move on to another type which has a physical meaning. Okay, so that is the, okay, this is just to show you that all of these things are an iterative approach. You have experiments with high throughput data, data handling, assays, which will give you this, and some sort of models, and you iterate them. It's a typical flow. Now, why networks? I will come to the other physical networks in a minute. So why networks? Networks are very important, not just for biology, and that's, in fact, biology is a recent entry into this thing, but networks have been used in a variety of different things. And the best ones, which you can, I'm sure, relate to, will be the internet network or your social networks, Facebook and Twitter and all of these kind of things, or the electronic circuits that are there, or the power grids, or water distribution systems, or something even more closer home that we all see every day will be traffic networks. Okay, so there are roads and junctions and so on. Everything is connected. Otherwise, no point of having that road if it doesn't lead you beyond node A and node B. If it doesn't take you anywhere, it will just be within your house, for example, and doesn't take you any further. So important nodes will be those, the highways, which can take you from city to city and so on. So there are those kind of networks that are out there. They're actually there in real life. These are abstracted as graphs, basically, where we have nodes and edges, and we can have different kinds of values associated to the node and the edge. So in biology, we have a gene regulatory network, correlation networks, or protein-protein interaction networks, which are more physical in nature. That's the kind of thing. So in biological systems, it becomes even more important because there are modules. You know, it's inherently modular. There's increasing evidence that the cell system is composed of modules. A module in a biological, So modules defined based on functional criteria reflect the critical level of biological organization. And a modular system can reuse existing well-tested modules. So there's a lot understood about certain modules. At least we know we can draw the boundaries of the module and so on. And functional modules will be reflected in the topological structures of biological networks. And identifying these modules and the relationship will help understand the organization, evolution, and interaction of the cellular systems they represent. Therefore, they're of interest to us. And examples of these modules now. A pathway that I talked to you about could be a module by itself. So here you have UMP all the way going to CTP. Or they're linked up in this form. It doesn't have to be a linear one always. And it's very rarely a linear one. So you will have a network of this kind. The same thing represented in three different ways with different extents of detail there. And then we have a graph G with V and E, number of vertices and edges, basically. And the graph properties, you can associate properties to each edge. An edge now can have a direction, right? It goes only from A to B. Okay, sometimes you have them as bidirectional, which means A to B or B to A, but sometimes it is only in a single direction. So you can either have an undirected or a directed, but the more the directions that you have, the better your network is going to be. You can also have weights associated with them. How big is, how thick should my edge be drawn? Right? How important is the edge? So I can give a value of, say, in a scale of 0 to 1.1, or it could be 0.9. And graphically, it is represented by thickening this line. You know, 0.9 is thicker the edge that is drawn. That's what you will see sometimes. So directions and weights is what makes it very interesting, basically. And these nodes can also be weighted. They can be weighted, for example, in the lab, what we do is to weight them based on the abundance that is there. How many copies of this gene or protein are present? This is an abstraction for a protein. And the interaction that we draw here is actually a protein-protein interaction. Now, when do proteins interact with each other? All the time, basically. But some are direct interactions, some are indirect. Direct ones can be like in an assembly of a photosynthetic center, right? Or a ribosome complex, or a proteasomal, you know, your protein degradation machinery, ubiquitin, ligases, many things have to come together, right? One protein has to bind to another protein, another binds to another, and so on. It forms a big complex. So those complexes can be represented as edges here. Each interaction is an edge. But there are times, number of times again, where the interaction is indirect. That means protein A has an influence on protein B, either through a carbohydrate, or through a nucleic acid, or through a small molecule metabolite, and so on and so forth. There can be different ways. They have a direct influence on each other. For example, two enzymes in a metabolic pathway. A gives rise to B, B gives rise to C, and so on, right? With E1, E2. Enzymes A to B is catalyzed by E1, B to C is catalyzed by E2. E1 and E2 need not form a physical complex. They don't have to form a structural complex, is what I mean. But the function of E2 is dependent on the function of E1. And vice versa, if there is a feedback inhibition or feedback, some sort of a feedback is there for that. So E1 to E2, you can draw an edge with a different type of weight associated with that. So there are methods for that. So you have here what you get out of these interactions is the network topology, who is connected to whom and so on, so the connectivity structure. And within that, there can be modules. Some are more densely connected than the others. I'll quickly show you some examples. You can have subgraphs, which are actually modules or densely connected components and so on. You also get information about a hub. Who is the most connected individual in the entire network? If you go back to traffic networks, it may be the city center, the most connected individual node. You also can find out if there are cliques. Cliques means everybody is talking to everybody within that subgraph that's out there. For example, if there is an individual laboratory where you may be working, obviously everybody will be talking to everybody, right? So you will form a clique. Whereas if you look at a neighboring lab, not all will be connected. Maybe one person may be connected, or a neighboring institution or a neighboring country, if you like, there'll be fewer connections. That kind of a thing is what you can find out. And now you want to reach, say, person X in somewhere else in the world. How many different people should you go through? Okay, let's assume you can't send them an email, but you can only send a mail through known people. So what is the number of hops that you need to find in order to reach that other person? Those kind of calculations are done. Those are the paths and subgraphs, basically. And it's found out that biological networks are small world networks, basically. Every node can be reached from every other by a small number of hops or steps. Means the diameter of the network is not very big, which I'll show you. And a high clustering coefficient is found in parts, and a low mean shortest path length. I'll tell you what I mean by this in a minute. This is similar to social networks, the internet, and biological networks. All of them exhibit what is called a small world network characteristics. Okay, let's look at some terminology here. The degree distribution. Now, the degree means how many nodes are connected to that given node. So how many people do you talk to? Basically, that's the degree. So each one is different here. This one has a degree of 4, whereas this one has a degree of 3, and this one, each one is very different. This one has a degree of 1. It's only connected to one other node in the thing. So in biological networks are what is called as scale-free networks or small world networks as compared to random networks. So in random networks, it's kind of distributed. So the probability of each degree K that you find, it's the fraction of nodes having that degree, is a normal distribution for random networks. See, if you look at the distribution there, it's random. Whereas for biological networks, it is a scale-free distribution. So the distribution often follows a power law, and therefore it's called scale-free networks, which means that some individuals are connected to many other individuals, or there are hubs, and most are not connected to that many people, which makes a lot of sense, really. So most biological networks are almost all that we have seen are scale-free networks, which are not correlated networks. Even correlated networks show that, but physical networks necessarily show this behavior. There may be something in between. I mean, these are, I'm sure you will find, but most networks that people have looked at do show a scale-free thing for this one. In fact, that is used for actually reconstructing a network many times. It's to that level of this thing. So there are also other properties, such as cellular networks are assortative. That means hubs tend not to interact directly with other hubs. Hubs are distributed in some form. Hubs also tend to be older proteins. This is, again, debated, but some observations that people have made, in the sense they have evolved much more than other proteins, kind of a thing. They're also found in ancient organisms or much more conserved through evolution and so on. So hubs also seem to have more evolutionary pressure. Their protein sequences are more conserved than average between species, example in yeast versus worm and so on. Experimentally determined protein complexes tend to contain solely essential or non-essential proteins, further evidence for modularity. Again, these are all some observations, really. So the network measures that we are looking at are the degree distribution, which I told you, The mean path length, how many hops do you need to find to use to reach node A from node B, any node from any node, basically. The network diameter, which I'll show you, and the clustering coefficient, which let us see. Now, the degree we have already seen, the clustering coefficient will tell you what is the clickishness in that particular thing. In a scale of 0 to 1, if 1 tells you that every player is connected to every other player, that will be a value of 1. That's a CC of 1. If nobody talks to nobody, if it is not, it's not really a graph then, it's our isolated nodes, then it will be 0. But usually it's somewhere in between. And some modules, the clustering coefficient is high, and some modules it will be low. But for a full genome scale network, the clustering coefficient is as low as 0.04 or something of the kind in a scale of 0 to 1. But for a module, it can be as high as 0.7 or 0.8 or 0.9 or whatever that may be. So that will tell you the clustering coefficient. The characteristic path length now are the number of edges in the shortest path between two vertices. When I told you that we need to reach one node from another node, we can go through all over the world and come back to that other node. But that is not the correct way of looking at it. We must find the shortest way of reaching that other node. That's called the shortest path. Again, go back to the city pattern. If you want to reach from one junction to another junction, if because the city is connected, you can go, in fact, all over India and come back. Right? That will not be the shortest path or the correct path length. You will not get the right answer. You need to find the shortest way of reaching this other junction. That will be the geodesic shortest path. This is what it's called as. And how many hops are there in that? That will be the path length. And if you do this for all versus all nodes, okay, the largest shortest path will be your diameter of your network. In the sense, from anywhere to anywhere, what is the maximum number of nodes that one has to take? That will give you the diameter or the size of your city, right? So from which junction to which other junction will require the largest number of hops. It is the shortest path, but the largest number of hops. That will define the boundaries of your city. So that's the diameter. Another kind of thing is called a betweenness centrality. The various centrality measures, the node degree itself is a way of defining centrality. Now, centrality, as the name indicates, how central is a given node in the whole network, in the topology of that network. You can do node centrality. You can also do edge centrality. Now, edge centrality, again, going back to your traffic networks, is like how inevitable is it to use this particular road from junction A to junction B to reach anywhere to anywhere in the city. Okay, if it is a city center connecting to some very important hub area in your city, then it will be inevitable that traffic goes through that thing to cross from one area to another area. So that's called as betweenness centrality, basically. Let me quickly go through some slides that are there. Again, degree, if you have a directed network, you can have in degree or out degree. In degree is how many connections are coming towards you. Out degree is how many connections are going out. Because it's a directed network, how many proteins interact with this protein A is different from this protein influencing other proteins, right? So that's called in degree and out degree out there. And let me skip all of these things. So this is a directed graph out there. You can also have cycles like this. You can have cycles just in two or in this particular kind of a thing. So you can also have acyclic graphs. Again, because we are constructing from data that is available, we are not trying to fit it to any particular kind of thing. You take what you have. I won't spend too much time on this in the interest of time, but walks, paths, and cycles, as I'm saying. A walk is a sequence of edges. A path is the shortest path between this edge, between node A and node B. A cycle is when it is connected back like that. And a geodesic is nothing but the shortest path out there. There are also modules that people look at. Is it a tree? Is it a ring or a star? And things like that. And when you find these kind of modules recurring frequently in different biological networks, it can have a certain meaning. So people also look at motifs. These are called as network motifs, you know, quite often.
What's the bipartite?
Bipartite network now is when you have two types of nodes. Like, for example, you have, let us say, doctors and patients. A doctor is connected to several patients, and a patient may go to multiple doctors at a time. So if you make that kind of a network, the nodes are of different types. So it's called as a bipartite network. You can have three types of nodes. That's all. It's a tripartite net. The node has a different characteristics. The node label or the flag of the label, like you can have colors, red, blue, green. Red is a node, blue is a green node, and green is a node. There are many reds, many blues, many greens, but interacting in that form. So that becomes a tripartite network. The node label and therefore the node function becomes different. Exactly. You can have like that. Yeah. Protein, metabolite, drug, these are the kind of things that we look at. Neighborhood and degree, again, let me skip. I think I have covered this already. The diameter, as I told you, is the largest distance between any two nodes in the thing as defined by the shortest paths. So it is the largest, shortest path, basically. Centrality is the same as betweenness that we talked about. Degree centrality simply means the degree, the largest degree. Closeness centrality, it is tracks how close a given node is to any other node. So how closely connected is it in a cluster and so on, that's closeness centrality. Edge betweenness is what I talked about here. That is the short, the path, number of times a path is, an edge is traversed in all the shortest paths from node A to node B. Yes. Yeah, node centrality is just the, nothing but the degree.
And edge centrality will be the edges connected to hub.
How central is that particular edge in the network? That is the edge centrality. Clustering coefficient is like this. Now, the what is the, out of all the possible edges that can be there in this thing, how many edges are seen? That is your clustering coefficient. Theoretically, everybody can be talking to everybody. There are certain, if there are n nodes, there are the, you know, all possible combinations of edges that you can find out there. And what are the number of edges that you actually see as compared to the number of edges that are theoretically possible? That will be a clustering coefficient. Basically, so again, let me skip. I think we can figure this out quite easily. So this is the summary of that. Let me just quickly tell you the algorithms that are there for the shortest path analysis for Dijkstra's algorithm. So the shortest path problem is there are many methods for calculating this shortest path. Dijkstra is one of them. There are also something called Floyd-Warsh algorithm and so on. Again, I don't have time to go into this in detail, but how do you actually find the shortest path of that? You know, there are algorithms, again, available in most of this. I think Satya may be able to give a quick demo. So let me skip this and show you some examples instead. Okay, sorry about that. Yeah. So this is an example of a shortest path between these two nodes here. And this is the diameter, the longest shortest path. Okay. And what kind of analysis can you use this for? That's what I want to talk about in the next few minutes. So an example that I show you here is a node deletion. Say I have a bacterial system with me and I want to use it for, say, drug target identification, which is a good drug target in my bacterial system that I want to see. It's equivalent to performing a knockout, a computational or a modeling a knockout of a particular gene. So here I've knocked out this particular node. You can do a knockout genetically or you can do a knockout through a drug or through an antibody or whatever that may be, you know, knockout means. And so here we are simply removing this node. When you remove that node, all the edges related to that also goes. So you lose a large number of edges like this one. So you go on doing this systematically for each node in the network to find out what is the maximum perturbation that you can see. Are some shortest paths now lost, completely lost, is the question that you can ask. It's also called as a broken path analysis. Is the city being split into two parts, for example? Okay, or at least is there something that comes out as a separate cluster with very loose links to the rest of the city? That's the kind of question you can ask. And such proteins may be good drug targets, you know, as we've seen. You can construct with this kind of a thing a genome scale network for any genome at a full comprehensive scale. So I think it's quite often referred to as interactome also. Now, it's an example is shown here. You have protein A, protein B, protein C, and all the way to the 20,000 proteins out there. And you construct a network by looking at different bioinformatics methods and overlaying the experimental information that is available out there. Very quickly, to give you an idea, if experimental data is available that protein A is linked to protein B, then you can take it directly because that is available. That may also be context dependent and condition dependent. Okay, that's a different matter. And here you can also use methods such as domain fusion. You know, I think David Eisenberg and teams quite some time ago came out with this method called, if in a given polypeptide chain, there are two open reading frames in the same polypeptide chain, which in a different species is seen as two different polypeptide chains, right? It's a single chain, two domains or two proteins, But in another species, it is separated out. So there's a strong correlation that these two proteins in a given polypeptide chain must be linking with each other. They must be influencing each other. Therefore, they are on a single one. But in another species, they are either close by or somewhere, but then they are interacting with each other. You know, that's the logic that is there. If they are found to be together in any species, they are considered to be interacting with each other. And there's a lot of evidence to support that. Or they are in the neighborhood, in the genome context, they are in an operon, for example, or they are always conserved through evolution to be neighbors of each other at the gene organization level, then they are taken as interacting. Or if they are phylogenetically conserved, or if they are co-expressed sometimes, they can draw an edge. These are the kind of things that people look at. Okay, and there's a different weightage given to different kinds of interactions. Like for example, here in a metabolic network, M is a metabolite, R1 makes M, R3 utilizes M. Now R1 and R3, the enzymes P1 and P3 here, the proteins, are linked to each other through a higher linkage than two proteins making the same metabolite. P1 and P2 both make the metabolite. Since the metabolite pool, there's some homeostasis and it must be conserved, P1 has some influence on P2. Okay, so that is a lesser weightage than the direct one between P1 and P3 or P1 and P4, which, you know, these consecutive steps in a pathway. You can draw graphs like this protein-protein influence matrix out of all the known data. And obviously here, any dot represents that there is an influence. And you will see that this is organized in a logical manner, in the operon kind of a thing. So these are all off the diagonal. I don't know if you can appreciate that. That means neighboring genes have a higher influence than genes which are further away.
Correlation?
This is not correlation. This is actually interaction influences, basically, between one protein and another protein. But they're ordered based on their occurrence in the genome, and therefore you see a graph of this kind. So the ones which are next to each other are interacting with them much more. That's why you see that. Okay. But you'll also see some hubs. If you look at that, this is interacting with so many of them, so this is likely to be a hub, as compared to this 500th or 550, which has fewer interactions throughout. Okay, so this is a real graph for Mycobacterium tuberculosis, genome scale metabolic model like this. There are about 661 genes in this, and the different pathways are given different colors, the different clusters, and necessarily the ones in a pathway are coming together, but you'll also see edges that are coming between pathways, so which tells you the interaction between different pathways is shown here. This is different for different organisms now. Here you will see the central citric acid cycle, which is an important pathway. There are, of course, it is in the center, but you'll also see something unique in mycobacteria, which is membrane metabolism and fatty acid metabolism. It's a weighted graph, so the edges thicken quite a bit here. So that is quite high. So you get insights about which processes, which pathway is connected to which pathway and so on. But just for the fun of it, we looked at a higher order organization and put all processes. You know, a process has many pathways. For example, carbohydrate metabolism has all these pathways. And see which one is connected to which one. And you will get a graph which is a click, which has a clustering coefficient of 1. Every process is connected to every other process, which just shows you how well orchestrated the metabolism is. You can ask a lot of questions, different types of questions on this protein-protein interactome. One example is, can we compare, say, Mycobacterium tuberculosis to Mycobacterium leprae? Leprae causes leprosy. Both are cousins, basically. But how conserved are their networks to each other is a question that you ask. And what we find is the core network is similar, but there are additional paths or alternate paths which are much higher in Mycobacterium tuberculosis as compared to leprae. Are there alternate routes to reach this particular thing? So if you knock out a shortest path, can it reach from some other kind of thing? Will that become a shortest path then? Those are the questions you can ask. You get essential hubs, critical nodes, and so on and so forth, many things. Let me skip this as well. So you can compare different ones, E. coli, human, tuberculosis, all of that, and you'll get some numbers. Again, I will skip this. You can also construct a network view of diseases. Which two diseases are similar to each other? Now, is asthma, for example, and flu, do they have something in common? Right? The phenotype, the behavior that a doctor sees, for example, may have something in common. The genotype, our transcript signatures and the changes that happen may also have something in common. So can we construct a disease gene network? In fact, there's a paper as long ago as 2007 that it was done. There are a lot of work that's going on in this area, a network view of diseases which looks at the mutations or the genome variations that occur in different diseases. Can we connect them together, and will we get some ideas about that? All of this has, you know, a lot of implications for what sort of diagnosis, what sort of treatment or vaccines that can be repurposed in some sense. You know, you can have a comparative network here. And like I said, for human polypharmacology, we can utilize these networks. If a drug given for asthma is also useful for lung cancer, for example, you know, or vice versa, then we can actually explore those possibilities from here, form hypotheses that come out of this, and go back to the lab and test it. So that's the kind of thing that you will get. Finally, you can go all the way from molecular networks to disease, these kind of networks, and all the way to social networks to make epidemiology models. You know, that is actually possible, all with this kind of foundation of connecting proteins with each other. What I must also emphasize is, when we say protein-protein interaction network, proteins carry with them the nucleic acids if they are bound, or the carbohydrates or the lipids, or the metabolites. So it actually connects all sorts of molecular interactions that are possible in a cell. I'll stop now and take questions. Thank you. Yes, please.
Can you tell us a few good software for network visualization?
Satya is actually going to demonstrate. Cytoscape is one thing. So in the next slot, she is going to show you.
They support batch mode? Batch mode?
Please, yeah, you can download and do it on your laptop or whatever.
What distance was in network?
Distance it doesn't have a physical meaning. It is the strength of interaction of that edge, or the strength of correlation. I mean, the one minus.
That's the width.
That's the width. Oh, distance has no physical meaning. It's just drawn for aesthetic purposes, they're put together. But you can actually use this thing for, say, protein structure networks. Then the distance is your bond length. You can actually have that kind of a formulation. All right, so I think we are breaking for tea now, and we'll reassemble. Yeah, thanks.
Announcements. No? Okay, yeah. Yeah, too related to travel. So for people from outside Bangalore, please go to the registration desk and fill up your travel form so that you get your money back. And for people from within Bangalore, no, you're not getting any money. But the shuttles to IISc and NCBS are at 6 o'clock today, just to let you know.